And the next speaker is Roberto Salerno, and I hope he's here. I check.
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Fantastic.
So let me introduce Roberto to you. He's a CNRS scientist and professor at Ecole Polytechnique. And he has been the convener of CMS Higgs between 2017 and 2019. And he is currently a member of the steering group of the LHC Higgs working group. And he will talk about measurement of the mass, spin, and width of the Higgs boson. Okay, it's a pleasure to have you. And please go ahead with your talk.
Thank you so much for this introduction. Let me share the slides. I suppose that you can see them. Is it the case?
I can see, but it's, I think, small.
Yeah. Sorry. Now I will go there. And then now you can see totally projected.
Yeah, it is.
And you can see even the pointer.
Yes.
Okay, that's fantastic. So again, thank you for this invitation. Actually, I will not speak about spin because there is a dedicated CP talk later tomorrow delivered by Monk. And I will focus mainly on start from the mass of the Higgs boson, the measurements of the mass of the Higgs boson. Then I will move towards the total width measurements of the Higgs boson. And relating with this one, I will discuss as well the branching fraction of the Higgs boson to invisible particles. So there are three main measurements that I will highlight in my presentation. And after all, each of them, there is a small summary. So feel free to stop me at any moment. I can answer a question and we can discuss any points during my talk. I don't have any problem to be interrupted. So let's start the main point on the measurements of the mass of the Higgs boson. Now, just a single slide of introduction. You know, the Brout-Englert-Higgs mechanism. This mechanism is an economical way to give mass to the particles, vector boson, fermion as well, keeping the theory gauge invariant. And the field is responsible electro weak symmetry breaking. We are here to celebrate the discovery of the Higgs boson. And indeed, there is only one particle in this theory, that is the Higgs boson. And there is only one unknown in all the theory, that is the Higgs boson mass. So the first part is discussing about the measurement of this only unknown of the theory, that is the Higgs boson mass. Now, in this slide, I want to put on perspective, I mean, not on perspective, on put some points on what is the Higgs boson mass and what is not the Higgs boson mass. And here there is a simple list. First of all, the Higgs boson mass is not a prediction of the theory. What we said is an unknown, but the Higgs boson mass is a free input parameter of the theory. It's not a prediction, but it's a free input parameter. Now, when we measure the Higgs boson mass, this is not a test of the standard model, because the standard model does not tell us the mass of the Higgs boson. So it's not the test of the standard model, but what is an important ingredient of the standard model prediction of many mass-dependent standard model observable. So it's not a test of the standard model, but it's fundamental. From my point of view, I would argue that it's one of the most important ingredients of the standard model, the Higgs boson mass, to make predictions. Within predictions, clearly, we know the Higgs boson mass and we can make prediction of Higgs boson observables, like coupling, branching ratio, width of the Higgs boson. But we can make as well, thanks to the Higgs boson mass, precise prediction of most of the electroweak observables, like the mass of the W boson, the mass of the top quark, the effective mix angle, because it enters to make some correction on this mass. Now, again, what is important, the Higgs boson mass is connected to the Fermi and the Planck scales, and ultimately with the vacuum stability. There is this famous paper that he went out in 2013. About the connection of Higgs boson mass any as well the Higgs boson potential with two scales. Now, and as an example, next slide, the link between the mass of this boson and effects on electroweak observables. So, as I said, there are significant one-loop correction that are growing with the logarithm of the mass of Higgs boson for most of the electroweak observables. And I give you an example because we always cite this one. So this is, for example, the approximate parametrization of the mass of the W boson It's approximate because then you can make the perfect computation, but this is the approximate using this paper, and actually this approximation is using the G-fitter when they make an estimation, for example, of the mass of the W boson starting for all the electroweak observables. And you see that the mass of the W boson here is independent of the bare mass of the W boson plus some correction, and all these DH are logarithmic correction when the mass of the X boson enters. And indeed, in the G-fitter, as soon as you see the plot on the bottom, this is the expectation of the mass of the W boson in function on all the electroweak measurement in gray one. But as soon as we add as well the mass of the X boson within all the, let's say, electroweak observables to derive the mass of the W boson, you see that the estimation is shrink quite a lot, because it means that even if the correction, I mean, there is a logarithmic correction, there is a coefficient that I did not put here, but it's quite important, this kind of correction, to estimate the mass of the W boson. Similarly, another effect here, for example, what I said on the same one for the effective mixing angle, you see that going from the gray one to the blue one, as soon as we add the mass of the X boson that is precisely measured now at LHC, we start to have more precise estimation of all the electroweak observables. So this is an introduction about the importance of the measure the mass of the X boson to make prediction on X boson observables, like branch fraction, as I said, couplings and width of the X boson, but as well to electroweak measurements and observables. Now, how to measure the mass of the X boson at the CMS and Atlas? This is, in the previous talk, we went for machine learning and whatever. Now I'm even oversimplify the concept. So I want to measure the mass of the X boson. And the idea is that I profit of mass peaks, and in particular, profit of high resolution channels. So what is done? I put some CMS address as well plot here. What is done? I have a nice resolution peak, in particular when the X boson in the case, so for example, in 2Z boson and then 4 leptons or gamma-gamma, the peak that I totally can reconstruct the kinematic of the X boson and starting to measure the position of this peak, I go from max peak to mass measurements. So this is the flow of the first part of the talk. I try to describe this flow, and the mass measurement here, for example, is a likelihood, and I have the best measurement of the X boson mass combined, for example, two channels. In this case, is gamma gamma in blue one and ZZ in red one in CMS, and the combination is the black likelihood. Now, this is the concept oversimplified. Now I will instead put the concept schematized, and I will touch some of these boxes in the presentation. So, oversimplifies mass peak, mass measurements. Now, schematize, I start from some input objects that can be leptons, jets, gammas, and whatever. There is, as every single analysis, an event selection. And then after that, I will apply an event classification, because it's important. I will discuss why it's important having a classification in the mass measurement. So I have the next step is having signal and background models for all my categories after the classification. Here I inject some systematic uncertainty in each of these categories, because they count in the mass measurement, because it's a precise measurement. And then I fit all together using a Beanon and Bead maximum likelihood fit, where I can obtain, in this case, impact of the source of the impact of the different uncertainty. And finally, I have my result. What I got today, so this is the address topic. Every single step is important in mass measurements, but why is important? For example, the event classification, I will discuss some of the signal and background models using the mass measurement and the main systematic uncertainty attached to them, the impact of the systematic, and I go up to the final results. So this is the outline of the next slides. Let's start with categories. Categories is important in mass measurement and in any analysis, because exploiting categories, we can improve the sensitivity. Events, in particular in mass measurement, are categorized in function of production mechanism, invariant mass resolutions, and final states, because each of these categories has a different, let's say, mass resolution and the signal of the background. And so we gain if we can split the events in category. Clearly, this is an example, for example, in gamma-gamma. In gamma-gamma, this is the analysis done for the mass measurement, and it's profiting of having seven categories in this case. Each of them, as you can see on the plot on the left side, are categories that, for example, the UNTAG, they are mainly tagged gluon fusion production, while the VDF, as the name said, are categories that are mainly tagged VDF production. And each of them, they have a different, when I have the model of the signal in each category, they have a different width of the signal in each category, going from the best category, that is the UNTAG zero, then you can have a effective sigma of the model of this category order of 1.3 GV up to the worst categories, that is the Antarctic. So an important step, we need to categorize. We need to categorize to have a different, let's say, resolution, because we need a mass peak, I remind you, a different resolution in signal background in each category. First step. Second step, I have this category, then I have to, let's say, fit as much as better as I can both the signal and the background models. And what is important, that the model should be derived in each of these categories. An example is here, an example for four leptons, one of the two analyses that are used for the mass measurement. What events are parametrized? Are parametrized using a double crystal ball that means a Gaussian core plus some power low left and right tail to take care of the resolution detector effect and the resolution. And there are key parameters in this model. The key parameters that once I parameterize the signal and the background, in particular for one concern, the signal are the mean and the standard deviation of the Gaussian core. Because these two parameters then are the most important one then to determine our mass measurement. And in particular, both of them, in the analysis of CMS and ATLAS, they are parameterized in function of the possible mass measurement, that is our final measurement that we want to take. So key parameters on each of the model basically is the mean of the peak and the how large is our signal model. Similarly, I just put here, for example, for the gamma-gamma, instead of having a double crystal ball that is a Gaussian core plus the two exponential tail, is used the sum of four Gaussian. So we touch the model that are used in the mass measurement. Now, they are systematics. As I said, I have a signal in the background model, and the key parameters of this model basically is the mean of the peak and the width of the distribution, and attached to both of them, there are some systematics. For example, main systematic for leptons are the scale. So the precision on which I can measure the scale of my object, the energy scale, momentum scale in this case, to be precise, of my object with respect to what it expected. And this is a two example of the precision on which we can measure the momentum scale for electron on the left side and for muon on the right side in CMS. The y-axis, as is written, I just put reference, is the relative difference between the dielectron mass peak position in data simulation. To measure the scale, we tag events to have a single Z boson on shell, and we measure the difference between data and Monte Carlo. And we see that we can reach a great precision, order of 1 per mil for muon, is this span in function of all the muon PT range, and basically 2 per mil for electron. And as I said, this is, for example, for lepton, is the main systematics that is affecting the mean Gaussian core. You can easily understand, because if you change the scale of your objects that are the leptons, then the mean of the core of the Gaussian, you can move left or right. So, and to understand how this systematic goes to the core, then what the size of the relative difference is propagated. So this relative difference that is here, this plot, this value is propagated to the X Monte Carlo events, and at the end, the uncertainty is determined to be this kind of order, less than, let's say, between 3 per mil and 0.4 per cent. So 0.4 per mil in function of the possible, let's say, final state. Another important systematics for the leptons is the resolution. So we said there are two parameters in the model, the width, the mean and the width. And the width of the model clearly is affected by the resolution in which we measure our objects, leptons in this case, in the case of four leptons. And similarly as before, this plot shows the relative difference of the effective momentum resolution in data simulation once you target Z boson. Now the shift is, it's a different order of magnitude, the resolution, the relative difference of the resolution with respect to the previous scale, because it goes from 10 to 20%. But again, similarly, This is the main systematic affecting the Gaussian core, and certainly is determining to be conservative order of 20% in the four lepton analysis. Now, photon. What is one? They are similar systematic on neutron object, but in particular for photon, there are sensitive that we have to consider because of the fact that some of the properties of the photon are measured, for example, using electrons. So if there is a difference between the electrons that are used to measure the properties of the photon and the photon that are the end, the final object that are used in the analysis, we have to take care of this kind of differences in our analysis. So one of the dominant systematic, for example, is the uncertainty to do the difference between electron and photons, as I said. One difference is you have your crystal, that is the BWO4 crystal in CMS, that is as a radiation length that is the order of 0.9 centimeter. Now, the Schauer maximum of photon in the crystal is deeper than the one of the electron, is deeper on one radiation length. And due to the radiation damage of the Hilbert crystal and the impact of the uniformity of these things, could be important the fact that the maximum of the radiation length, the maximum of the Schauer maximum of the photon electron are different because you are using electron to measure properties of the photon, and then you have to propagate on the photon. So study has been done, for example, for the photon analysis, and this plot show the difference between electron and photon energy scale from the radiation damage induced by non-uniformity and differences because of radiation length, and we have this kind of, let's say, scale of difference going from less than 1.6 in the barrel up to 4.4. So I touch something about systematics now. So we went from the we start from the categories, we have the signal model, and each of the model are systematic attached to the model, and I attach some of the main systematics. But it's not the end of the story, because it's like I want to do a single 1D analysis, only one dimensional analysis fitting only on the Gaussian core and exponential tails or the different Gaussian, so the peak of this 1D distribution. But I can improve the sensitivity in my measurement, adding additional information, for example. So I increase the dimension of the fit. I don't only fit the signal model, but I fit another dimension that I will explain. Or, for example, in Z for lepton channel, I can use what is called a Z-max constraint, and indeed is used. So example of adding additional information. I don't only fit the invariant mass, the mass peak, to have the mass measurement. But, for example, I fit the mass peak convoluted with the parent event level resolution. So each event has its own resolution. I can estimate its own resolution. For example, Atlas is predicting using a neural net. So we come back to the important one in machine learning, as we discussed before. And at the end of the day, the fit is a 2D dimensional fit. In CMS, not only, for example, we are fitting the invariant mass, but we are fitting what is called a kinematic discriminant. So a discriminant that is used to better discriminate the signal and background. So adding additional information helps to, let's say, improve the sensitivity of the fit. This is additional information. Another example instead is the kinematical fit. What does it mean? The basic idea is to reevaluate the kinematic or the final state particles, adding and constraining that in the XZZ for lepton channel, two leptons, they are coming from the Zeton shell. So I have an X at 125 GD. This X is decaying two Z bosons, one of the two most likely. In most of the case, one of the two is on shell. And so knowing this constraint, I can change, reevaluate the kinematics of the final state particles, knowing that the X, two of these leptons are coming from a Zeton shell. And this is what this means using a kinematical fit, using the Z-max constraint, ZZ. And it's done, for example, in CMS analysis. And you see that for these are four muon and four E, two final states in ZZ for lepton analysis, as soon as I apply this kind of kinematical refit, with and without, with in blue, and without in blue, you see that you shrink the distribution. The resolution on my signal model becomes smaller. So one of the two parameters important in the mass measurement is becoming more precise, and so I could have basically a more precise measurement. So now, putting all together, let's see, for example, how all this kind of additional information to improve the sensitivity helps to have a better measurement. So if I start this one, what is my pointer? In 1D simple likelihood, when I only fit the, let's say, invariant mass of the four leptons, and instead, when I go on the bottom left, it is the best result, when I fit not only the invariant mass of the lepton, but I fit as well something that is similar or the pair event, whatever resolution that they discuss, the kinematic discriminant, and as well, everything is prime because it's adding a constraint. So from the best result to the most simple result, I can improve up to 24% my sensitivity. So these analyses are not only simply must pick at the end, but they are complex analyses. I hope that they convey the message because they have categories. Each of the categories, they have a model, signal and background model with their own systematics. And then we try to improve the analysis, adding more dimension and as well, kinematic fit. This is an example. Going down, we add the second strain. Going left, I add more information and I improve from up to 21%. Okay, now observed results in CMS, just to give you the numbers at the end, the measurements indeed. We did all the descriptions, so let's arrive to the measurement. So, for example, the MH is a strat by performing a simultaneous profiling likelihood fitting all the analysis categories and all the mod in all the dimension. This is just an example of the profile likelihood fit. The likelihood scan in function of the mass of the Higgs boson in the ZZ four lepton analysis for the three final states. You see that as soon as the parabola is shrink, it means that the measure is more precise in that final state. The three colors are for mu, and you see that the most precise final state to measure the mass of the Higgs boson, because the shrink parabola is, in, for example, in 4 mu, with respect, then after that, we have 2 mu, and finally, we have 4e, and the combination is the black one. Dotted, it means that I just consider statistical only uncertainty. And the fact that the dotted line is close to the solid one, it means that this analysis is dominated by statistical uncertainty. Even if I have some systematic uncertainty, at the end, statistic counts. So I can add statistics up to the end, up to high luminosity LHC, and is the limited factor to have the precise measurement at the moment. Now, having the combination, I mean, it's not only important to have a single analysis, but at the end, what we do, we combine the two channels and we combine different data sets, and this is the final results on CMS. You see, in the first box is the gamma gamma mass measurement around one, ZZ for lepton, and the combined one. Similarly, we have in CMS the results for using the 2016 RR2 data set for gamma gamma and ZZ, and the final combined. And the final result, and the most precise at LHC at the moment, is the combination of gamma gamma and ZZ analysis, run one, and 2016 run two. And this is this number, the most precise result is 125.38 GV with the uncertainty of 140 MeV. And the statistical component that is dominated is 110 MeV. Now, I not only quote by I'm quoting the number reading the block, but I have a next slide. This is the most precise LHC result, as I said. And the next slide is this one. Now let's look at the uncertainty. So we have our results, and then we can extract the uncertainty and understand this number. So this is the most precise, that is exactly the same previous figure. And then, as I said, I have 140 MeV precision that is dominated by statistical uncertainty, I want to underline. It's a relative precision that is 1.1 per mil, and is among the most precise electroweak parameters. So we have some electroweak parameters, effective angle, whatever, and among the most precise indeed is the mass of the Higgs boson, despite it's just only 10 years that we discovered the Higgs boson. The systematics uncertainty is dominated by, indeed, lepton and photon energy scalar resolution that I previously discussed. So total uncertainty is 140 GV, statistical one is 110 GV, and then in quadratus I can obtain the total statistically systematic uncertainty that is dominated by what we discussed. Now, we have a fact of four more data, so we could have statistical uncertainty comparable, so we have some thinking to improve them. But okay, this is another mess. I don't stop on here, but what is important to discuss is as well some projection to put in perspective for the future. And now, this is the best, what I show up to now is the best LHC measurement that we have on the market. What we can reach at high luminosity LHC with the CMS detector. This is, for example, for lepton. Is the expected, the table show you the expected mass measurement uncertainty given in EV for two different scenarios, an optimistic and a pessimistic one. The message, and this is still likely the scan and statistical and systematic uncertainty in black, and now statistical only in red. What you can grab from here, from this measurement, still, even at the end of high luminosity LHC, the statistic systematic, it will be greater in the four lepton channel with respect to systematic uncertainty. Statistical uncertainty will be greater than systematic uncertainty, or let's say order of the same magnitude. Let's put in the optimistic one. We will have a total systematic of 26 NEV. So we go from a factor seven smaller. We will have more than a factor seven smaller with respect to current uncertainty in this channel. Total uncertainty in the combined channel is 140 MeV, but in this channel in four lepton is 210 MeV. And we go down up more than a factor seven at the this projection at the high luminosity LHC. And the improvements are various improvements that we have enhanced indeed. We have a factor 10 more in luminosity. There is a new tracker with that material. There is precision and stability of that it will assure by the our new NCAP calorimeter. There are improvements in the barrel calorimeter, power suppression due to the new timing detectors and things like that. So we can go up to the factor seven. What is happening gamma-gamma instead? Similarly, like Luscan on the right side, we see that in this case, actually, okay, the measurement, it will be systematic dominant, because as soon as I have the statistical uncertainty only, the parabola is quite more shrinked with respect to the total one. And in any case, there will be a great reduction of the systematics. The table, it shows the impact of the expected systematic that we have at the end. And I put here in what we have today. And so you see that most of them, they will reduce order of a factor two, plus there will be no, it's supposed that we can not have any more than non-uniform, this systematic one that I was discussing before, that was order of 110 MeV. To summarize, we have a factor three improvement in gamma-gamma compared to the current measurement, and improvement are still the same. Okay, this is the future, the projection, and to finish, something that is important to say. Okay, you can grab, so at the end of high luminosity LHC, four lepton have order of 26-30 MeV of precision. This is fantastic for this mass measurement. By gamma-gamma, even effect of more than two uncertainty. And it seems that it's not competitive. But the enhance of this precision, it will be in any case super important, because it will be motivated by the fact that the mass measurement in gamma-gamma is affected by some interference effect between the production of the Higgs boson and the diphoton continuum. You can read in these references. So at the end of the day, even if the two measurements, one is dominating with respect to the other one by more than a factor two, but as soon as we will be able to measure the shift between the two mass measuring gamma-gamma and ZZ, the shift, this delta M, the shift between these two measurements is in a way a possibility to indirectly constrain the width of the Higgs boson. So even if one of the two is let's precise, it will be super important to have this one at the order of 70 MeV, because thanks to this one we can measure a possible shift up to, let's say, you see if the measure shift is on the y-axis, and if I measure a shift of order of less than 100 MeV, I can have indirectly precision on the measurement of the width of the Higgs boson, because this shift is, let's say, a function of the width of the Higgs boson, or a precise, indirect measurement of the width of the Higgs boson of the standard model of the Higgs boson, because 100 shift means order of one in the, this ratio of the width that I can measure. I hope that I convince you, and now I go to the summary of the first part, that first of all, the Higgs boson mass measurement is not a test of the standard model, but is a fundamental parameter for predictions. When a channel is not statistically limited, the control systematic is needed to obtain a precise measurement, and currently the most precise is coming from CMS with this value 125.38 GV with an error of 140 GV, and then we discuss as well the some projection for the future. This is finished the first part. I don't know if you want to ask question right now or I move. It's up to you. Tell me. I move on.
Any question?
If you wish. We finish.
How big is delta M is coming? Rather the width of the Higgs mass, because we assume narrow resonance, no? Narrow width.
So I it was difficult for me to hear because
slide 22. Previous slide.
Previous slide, yes. Previous this one. The mass the mass shift.
Yeah, mass shift.
Yes.
So don't we assume it is narrow width resonance?
It's assumed that is X, I can go in the next slide. So it's a perfect transition. X is a narrow width resonance in a way or another, but it's not assumed that it's a narrow width, because it's assumed that there is an interference indeed between the X and the and the and the and the background. But X in a way or another for MeV with on something that is order of 100 GV mass, it could be the narrow width. Most of the computation with using a narrow width works for the X, but in this case is not assumed narrow width, it's assumed with a finite width.
Okay. Okay.
I move on. Yeah. Then we can have a discussion later on with more topic. Okay. Okay. Now let's move to the second topic. I have a precise mass measurement and I can derive prediction as well for the X. And one of these one is the width of the X boson. So this plot show you in function of the previously unknown mass of the X boson, how it is the function, the value of the width of the X boson. There is a rise around 180 GV, 200 GV, when it's open up the decay in two on shell vector boson. The main point is that I know, now we know, we measure the mass that is order of 125 GV and the width is only 4.1 MeV. So this width, if we can measure with precision the width of this boson, is a crucial parameter for BSM searches. Because we can understand if the width is larger, what is predicted by the standard model in this way, knowing the mass of the Higgs boson, we can say that there are new undetected or unknown decay of the Higgs boson that is entering the game, and then it's a hint of something unexpected or deviation of what we are expecting. Now, we have to measure something that is three order of magnitude, or less, but smaller than the mass of the Higgs boson. We have a long experience measuring the width of electro weak boson, W and Z, but however, they were there. They were a factor, let's say, three order of magnitude bigger than the width of the Higgs boson. So the point is that the direct measurement is similar. In addition, at LHC, we are not measuring the in each tunnel, we are measuring the partial width on the contrary or left. That is, only we measure sigma times branching ratio can be measured. So, profiting on the detector only that you know as an order of one per or ballpark of 1% resolution to measure directly the width of the Higgs boson from the profile of the Higgs boson is super difficult. Indeed, there are, but in any case, there are different strategies. What I was just saying, there are direct measurements. So, what I want, I can measure the width directly measuring the own shell line shape of the Higgs boson. So how large is it? But this one the width is convoluted with the detector effect. So it's limited by detector resolution. Another possibility is that width, every time you have the width, it's quantum mechanic, no? It means lifetime. So if I can measure the lifetime of the Higgs boson, so how much it travels the Higgs boson, I can measure in a way or another the width. Is the previous formula, no? There is a the width in any case is elevated with the lifetime. Now, still, I think in the talk yesterday was said that most likely by Vivek that the Higgs boson decays most likely in the proton. I mean, it's not traveling so much. So another point is width from the lifetime is limited by detector solution. They are indirect measurement that it can be used to measure the width. One is the coupling. So measure the having a combined analysis of all the analysis, we can arrive to the width of this boson. The other one is having measured the on-shell production, and this is the way out. But in any case, let's touch a bit to the other case, that the main topic of this part will be the on-shell production and the measure the width thanks to the off-shell production, but I will touch the other topic. Now, from the line shape, I said, is a direct measurement. The natural width is convoluted with the experimental resolution. We have to profit of the excellent mass resolution of the two channels that they were the same one. Important to measure the mass of the Higgs boson, and here the important parameter indeed in the model is the width of the signal model. This is the best results that we have in hands, and then I think that is a kind of results without any model assumption. We measure the width of the Higgs boson with a precision of 1. I don't remember exactly the number. 1.1, I think, is GV. There are not a model assumption directly from the how large is the signal model, but the precision is 200 times the standard model width. That is a bit, let's say, far away, but okay. And it cannot be improved even if we have some projection. We always be limited by the detector resolution. Another point is that we can use the Higgs boson lifetime, and having this one, we can have a direct lower bound of the width. So the width, in a way or another, via H bar is related with the lifetime of the particle. And in particular, then we can have the width, the particle it travels, considering the standard model width, something like 48 femtometers. So basically close to what was said is within the proton, almost within the proton. But okay, if you can extract the C using our detector to see where the Higgs boson decays, we can have a lower bound on the width. We can say the width cannot be smaller than this value, because you see the relation of the lifetime and with respect to how much it traveled, and it's inversely proportional with the width. For lepton channel is the ideal channel to use this one. The experimental sensitivity is micrometer, it's not femtometer, but again, it has been used to put a lower bound on the width to say that is greater, 95% confidence levels of this value in ED. Okay, this is from lifetime, but it's nice to put this idea. We had an analysis in CMS to put a lower bound. But now we have to find a way out. And there was a great idea in 2013, I don't remember exactly the day, but okay, it was 2013. Oh, okay, so let's start to make some introduction. So the fixed width bright Widener scheme is generally good in describing the production, the inclusive production, that inclusive differential production of the Higgs boson. So that is this one, this sigma over the infinity element of the mass of the Higgs boson around the Higgs boson. And in this peak, the differential production is proportional to the coupling of the Higgs boson in with the initial state particle, the coupling square of the Higgs boson with the final state particle, and inversely proportional with the width of the Higgs boson. This is quantum mechanical quantum theory, and we have this kind of expression. Now, in this kind of expression, bright Widener, then we have the rapid fall at high mass. Okay, then that it goes down, and because here there is an M squared that appears in the denominator, and there is this rapid fall of the line shape. But this fixed bright Widener, as soon as we restrict to the WW decay, there will be a large off-shell contribution above the threshold. Ix virtuality. That means that the 2q squared propagator compensate the cross section, then is enhanced. So, inclusively, right before, but as soon as I concentrate on a differential in a WWD decay, I have an off-shell production of these bones. This is a bit exaggerated, the scale of this plot, but the message is I'm going differential in the X boson restricted to the VVV decay, and then the fact that there was this rapid fall in the propagator is not anymore true because there are two propagators. I mean, there is a formula with two propagators, the propagator for the production, and then another one that there is the decay, the contribution of the propagator compensated, the cross-section enhanced. And this one it was firstly seen when the X, firstly discussed when discussing the line shape for really high mass X boson by Passarini and Cowan. Then go back, it was as well discussed that this off-shell production instead is important for as well low mass X boson with low mass, I'm saying the 125 that we observe. Okay, so this plot is show you what I was just in discuss. They are the on shell and the off shell distribution. For the on shell distribution, now if I restrict to the decay of the X boson in ZZ, I see that still is proportional to the coupling of the incoming particle. I mean, incoming coupling of the X boson coupling with the incoming particle in the decay gluon fusion and the coupling square with the decay. And there is a inversion proportional of the width, while off shell the cross section there is no proportional of the with the X boson. So the idea, so now we know that the X boson in final state with vector boson has a not negligible off shell production, not negligible, but you see the order of magnitude of the peak is three times smaller with respect on the peak, but then you have to integrate this contribution of shell on the wall mass range. So there is not negligible. In one case, the differential cross section depends on the width, in particular on shell, and in the other case does not depend on the width. So the idea was, let's make a ratio. We make a ratio between the two measurements, and thanks to this ratio, some of the parameters they cancel out, in particular the couplings, and we making ratio to different measurement on shell and off shell, we can have a measurement of something that is only dependent of the width, natural width of the X boson. And this is the idea to use the off shell production of the X boson, a measurement of the off shell production of the X boson combined with the measurement of the on shell production of the X boson, make the ratio of these two values to extract a value of the natural width of the X boson. I hope that it was clear. This is just speaking about signal. Now, there is something that it comes in this measurement that it can, let's say, that we have to take into account. This is done in final state when the in particular, there's a large enhanced as usual in initial state when this boson is producing gluon fusion. Now, there is an irreducible background on this process, that it is the gluon fusion production via a box diagram of Z boson. This is the our X boson production. There is as well an irreducible background, and these two diagrams, when you compute the element square of the matrix, they interfere. So because you have the same initial and final state, so the total matrix element is the product, the sum of the two plus the interference there. And interference between these two diagrams is destructive. So it means that at the end of the day, off shell, if you sum up, let's say, the continuum and the production that is here in blue and in red one, you have the total contribution summing up signal and background that is, let's say, the interference is distracted. So the total contribution goes down. Actually, is at the end is a deficit with respect to the total expected background on the tail of the distribution. So something to take into account that in a way or another, it's important in the analysis. So you understand the I going quick because then I think that I only 20 minutes. So, and I have another topic. You understand the what we want to do. We want to measure cross-section on shell and off shell. This is important in particular in channel this is done in channel where the Higgs boson decay in vector bosons. At this point, we can use XZ for lepton. We can use even EZZ to L2 nu to as final state to have more, let's say, events. Or we can use XWW, all this channel, and then the KWW to L2 nu. All this channel has been used in CMS. Recently, there is an analysis that went out in CMS and combined the ZZ for lepton channel and ZZ to L2 nu channel. This is at the, for example, the off-shell distribution of these two final states. You see, for example, for the ZZ analysis that is combining this analysis, so I explain you the flow. So this is the expected background is in the blue one, and then the red one dashed is the contribution of off-shell. Off-shelling is for value higher than high mass. The contribution of the background, standard model, signal background, interference. This is the contribution in red, what you should expect, summing up signal, background, and interference. And then what are the data? And the same one for the ZZ to L2 nu analysis, where the final discriminating variable is the transverse mass of the 2Z. Instead, here, the final discriminating variable is the mass invariant mass of the four leptons. Again, the non-off-shell contribution is less consistent with the observed data, visible at high mass, and so we start to have events to start to make a measurement, and indeed it was what is done. Combine ZZ for lepton to L2 nu, using different assumption, we can put this plot show you the signal strength of shell, and this plot actually is the final result, is the measurement of the invariant measurement of the total width that make as the ratio of the on shell over off shell measurement. Here there is a of the on shell versus off shell measurement for different standard model like and different beyond standard model hypothesis, but the main message is over there. In the non off shell scenario, that it means non-off-shell scenario means there is no contribution of shell for the Higgs boson. That means at the end that the width is zero. Is this non-off-shell scenario, that is means width zero, so this zero is excluded at the confidence level greater than 99.9 confidence level. That means that with this analysis, excluding zero with more than 3 sigma, we can have a 3 sigma evidence of the Higgs boson production of shell. That is something already quite important, because up to now, all the analysis, they were profiting of the on-shell production of the Higgs boson to measure properties. Now, with this analysis, the first result is that we can have an evidence that the Higgs boson is not only as a contribution of the cross-section on shell, but we have an evidence finally that the Higgs boson has a contribution as well of shell. Now, again, making this ratio between the contribution of shell that we have an evidence of 3 sigma with respect to the contribution on shell that we know, we can arrive even to have a measurement of the, a force measurement of the width of this boson that is measured to be 3.2 MeV with an error that is order of 80%, 95 confidence level. That is a great result that went out for CMS a few weeks, let's say, at the beginning of this year. I skipped this slide because I think that how much time still I have? 20, 50 minutes, I suppose, or even less.
So you finish at 4:50, so you have time. 15 minutes.
15 minutes, I still have. Yeah, okay, but because then we keep some time for this.
For the question.
So I have another topic. And to conclude this chapter, instead, there are projections. Similarly, of what I show for the mass measurement, these slides show you the projection of the total width of the Higgs boson. And for two different possible scenarios, it was done in the context of the high luminosity, the last update of the strategy of the European for the particle physics. But the message is that we made some extrapolation. Today we have an evidence of the shell Higgs boson production with 3 sigma. We have the first measurement of the width of the total width of the Higgs boson using the off-shell production order of 3.1 MeV with an error of 80%. What we can done at the end of high luminosity HC is shown here. We can have a measurement of the width of the Higgs boson. This point. Clearly, this is our expected result. That's why they are the minimum of the parabola is on the expected the total width of this boson, it's 4.1 MeV, but we can have a an error order of, let's say, the projected interval at 2 sigma is between 2 and 6.1 MeV, and the error actually is 1 MeV. If you see 1 sigma band that is here, when I put the pointer, 1 MeV. It was extrapolating having two possible assumption and scenario. One is scenario S1 is exactly the same systematic that are using one in round two, and scenario S2 instead, the second one that you see that is slightly better results as an approximate what is called scenario two that has both theoretical and experimental uncertainty that are scaled, actually theoretical scaled by factor alpha and experimental uncertainty that is a floor in the sense that adding luminosity are scaled up to a certain point, but having most the same results for two scenarios, it means that actually this measurement basically is mainly statistically dominant. You see as well from the figures, the solid line, the purple one is with all the systematic sensor included, and as we go to the black one, dotted line is just only statistical uncertainty included, and they are close. That it means that this kind of measurement is a measurement that we can carry on up to high luminosity HC, and will be still statistically limited. And so, but in any case, we can move from an 80% currently precision on the width measurement width down to something that is indeed 20%, so more than 5 sigma. An observation of the on-shell production for sure, and a 20% precision on the. Okay, now summary of the second part. The point is that I want to underline that the off-shell Higgs boson production is sizable at high mass due to a compensating effect between the production and decays above the two mass of the two vector boson. In particular, this sizable off-shell effect is in when the Higgs boson decays in that vector boson. When we combine on-shell and off-shell and make the ratio of the two, we can have a measurement of the natural width of the Higgs boson. This is the trick. And allows this one for constraint order 100% better of the direct measurement, the first result that they show. It tends to increase statistical of the rank two and combination of two channel when the Higgs boson indicates a Z and final state either for lepton or to L2 nu allow to move from constraint to a measurement. We have the first evidence of the off-shell production, and we have a measurement that is, this is the value, that is 3.2 MeV with an error that is 80% or maybe less. And then this kind of measurement, actually, what I touched briefly, they can as well allow BSN couplings constraint. That's all. So the width is important. And what is the width in quantum mechanics? It's the sum of the partial width that is strictly related with the branch fraction of the Higgs boson, you know, the final state. And this is a nice transition to move towards the last chapter, shorter with respect to the previous one. It is a measurement of the branch fraction of the Higgs boson in invisible. I go on and maybe we discuss at the end. It's important that the Higgs boson in measure or having a constraint of the Higgs boson invisible. Why? Because first of all, there is a standard model branch fraction in Higgs boson invisible. That is the Higgs boson going to Z boson and four neutrino in the final state. But it's very small, it's 1 per million. So as soon as we observe a rate, namely a branch fraction enhanced in this final state, so Higgs boson invisible, it will be clear evidence for some beyond standard model physics. So having this measurement is important and it's fundamental for having now and for the future. Now, Higgs boson invisible can be a generic prediction on new physics models like dark matter. And in particular, if the dark matter mass is half of the mass of the Higgs boson. Clearly, we can have a production of collider. So we produce the null magnet tends to decay. I mean, we use the X as a tool where the X is decaying to the matter particle. And this is a super important topic that connects our field with as well the cosmology. And we know that the dark matter, it exists for sure. We know that it's most likely is natural. And we know that the energy scale and interaction of the dark matter must be closed. This is, we know, order of 1 TeV. So this could be a coincidence, I want to say, conclude this slide, or maybe a suggestion that the solution of the mass problem, of the dark matter problem that we have, could be even in the Higgs boson sector. So again, let's move and adding this kind of the of a measurement and the Higgs portal models in which a stable dark matter particle coupled with Higgs boson exist. Now, how to measure the Higgs boson invisible? We need visible particles in the sense that we have to measure the Higgs boson that indicates something that is visible, that emits missing energy. The common signature is missing energy, but we need something to tag this recoil of the Higgs boson. So we need particles to tag that the fact that the Higgs boson is decaying invisible. What is the best way to tag the Higgs boson? Moving from a production mechanism where we have some associated particle that it can be even VBF, that is a second most abundant production mechanism of the production of the Higgs boson at the LHC, or can be even the associated production, that it can even be analysis with the TTH. Alternatively, we can have inclusive production, I mean, gluon fusion production, but boosted. As soon as the production is boosted, most of the time there is an hard jet gluon that is in the final state to balance to recoil against the Higgs boson. What we focus today, I focus on the recent or the most, let's say, sensitive analysis, that is the production in VBF of the Higgs boson, thanks to the, as I said, thanks to the large cross section and distinct event topology. Higgs boson in VBF means two jets in the forward region that we can tag and jet with high invariant mass. This kind of production mechanism drives the overall sensitivity in direct search for invisible decays of the Higgs boson. Okay, now I go quick because it's a standard, in a way and another, analysis of the Higgs boson. It's a VBF search for the Higgs boson, but now just the tag is the VBF, and then the X is going to be visible. We have to tag the visible particles, so we tag events with a pair of jets with large angular separation. We know that it's a forward jet, delta eta, the jet is large, and large invariant mass, the typical topology of the VBF. We don't want any other particles, so there is lepton and photon beta. And events are triggered either using high missing energy or let's say VBF jets, and there are a few cuts to reduce additional background. These are the two, for example, signal region in the CMS analysis. One is what is called MTR signal region, that is missing momentum trigger region, because events in CMS are triggered here via a missing energy trigger or via VBF. Now,
sorry to interrupt.
Yes.
I have 5 minutes, Roberto.
Okay. Yes, I'm pretty at the end. This is the last part is shorter. So this is the possible contribution of a VBF to invisible in a dotted line for a branching fraction of order of 7%. If you assume that the X is decaying invisible with a branching fraction of 7%. Now, the results, just to show you, this is the most sensitive results in CMS, combining different year together, the color different year, and the combined one is the solid one. What we expect something that the dotted one and expecting, we said something to measure something that is a branching fraction that is zero by definition, because we know that is order of one per mil, but we measure something that is order of less than 10%, but with a large error, totally compatible with the expect zero. What is more important, instead of the measurement of branching fraction into invisible in this channel, is putting upper limit on the this branching fraction. The expected one in CMS was order of 10% with an observed upper limit of order of 80%. This measurement, as you can see from this table, about the impact of different systematic is somehow systematic uncertainty domain. Because you see the contribution of the statistical uncertainty is the same order of the theory one and other uncertainty. So some of these uncertainties related to the theory are related to some of the main background that are entering this analysis. It's not only important to put the constraint, but then we can interpret this branching fraction in X portal model when the, as I said at the beginning, when the X boson indicates into dark matter particles. And what we observe that the interpret this one in X portal model, in particular our results that are the dotted orange one and the dotted red one for these two different possible models when the when the mediator is the scalar or a vector dark matter, overperforms or the direct. The experiment to detect directly the dark matter, in particular up to in the low mass region. This is in function of the mass of the dark matter, and but clearly there is a cutoff because the main point is that we can have this interpretation only if the dark matter is half of the mass of the Higgs boson. Indeed, there is a kinematical threshold for the mass of twice the mass of the Higgs boson. I think that this is the final slide. This is the projection. As the other two chapters, I put a projection on the future. And assuming you have to grasp this message, assuming CMS and ATRA perform equally well in eclectic correlation, we can arrive at the end of high luminosity LHC, putting a constraint on the branching fraction of 2.5%. So expecting now both ATRAS and CMS are order of 10%. So at the end of the day, combining CMS and ATRAS, luminosity and LHC, we can improve by even a factor of 4 and going down to 2.5% with this direct measurement of the branching fraction X invisible in the BF channel. And at the end, almost the region will be explored. So we go down, you see the message, we go down to the coherent notinium scattering even better. So we cover all the region for the dark matter. So it's is a dark matter detector as well. LHC. This is concludes with the summary of the invisible. That is, invisible decay of the X is a natural place to look for new physics, and in particular for dark matter. As I said, all X production challenges, even rare ones, are being studied. I focus only on VBF, but as I said, there is as well analysis on RCC production, TTH, and X boosted. Now we are probing branching fraction of order of 10%, expected by ATRAS CMS, the observed one in CMS is 18%, and that we need to fight with systematic for future analysis. I think this is the last one, and it brings me to the conclusion that are not conclusion, but numbers on the best mass measurement at LHC, that actually is the one from CMS that I show you, the best total width measurement at LHC, that actually is the one from CMS. For branching fraction, we have, I showed this 18%, using the VBF, and that's all. Just a last word, you know, there are still with less than 5% of the final luminosity integrated luminosity, high luminosity LHC integrated luminosity that has been analyzed even less in some analysis like the mass measurement. So we have hopes and wishes for the future, and you have as well the talk related on this one in this week. And let's have these hopes and wishes for the future, and we have a lot of data in front of us, and then that's all. The last word is thank you to you for this invitation. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you, Roberto, for this very nice talk. Please, if there are any questions, please raise your hand.
Kajari. Yeah, last but one slide. You are talking about VBF plus gamma. Which of the channels CMS is pursuing?
Is analysis, is ATLAS.
Yeah, H to VB. But yeah. CMS has not started anything. Okay, fine, thank you.
Are there any other questions? Okay, I don't see any raised hands.
Thank you so much. So
I would let's thank Roberto again, and
it's
very nice talk, and let's move to the
thank next. Thank you for the invitation. I stop sharing and I mute myself.
Okay, so